Show, bring it on. I'm your hostess, Shin Ayong. This is our fourth season, and all of our presenters are eager to share their unique cultures right here on Arirang TV. So it's your chance once again to learn about the different culture, tradition, history, and system that make up our colorful world. Now let's start the show. Let's say hello to our judges. Now look who's back, Amy.
Hi!
Other judges, Ilya.
I'm very glad to be here, and I wish all the luck to you guys during our today's presentations.
And let's meet Robin, our official break dancer. Hello.
Woo!
Hi, everyone.
Welcome back, Robin. And of course, our lovely mascot, Abigail. I knew she was cute, but I didn't know she was that hot.
Woo! Woo!
Now, let's meet our contestant. We have continental representatives in each round of the preliminaries. And for this round, we have representing Europe from the United Kingdom. Oliver, hello.
Hello. Woo-hoo. Nice to meet you.
Hello. And representing Africa from Zambia, welcome, Kent.
Thanks for having me here.
Our Asian representative from Thailand, we have Tichara. Hello.
Hello. Sawadee from Thailand.
Now this season, we have some new countries being represented, and Zambia is one of them. So please tell us a little bit about your country, Kent. I know that Zambia, the word Zambia, the name Zambia, comes from a river. Am I right?
Yes, nah, you're right. Zambia, the name comes from the great river Zambezi, the longest river in southern part of Africa. And it's from the Zambezi River where you find the well-known Victoria Falls.
And Tatara, I know that Thailand also have a lot of tourist attractions, right?
Yeah, that's true. We're really popular for foreigners. I mean, like, from tourist attractions.
Mm-hmm.
So, a lot of people from around the world visit Thailand per year, so huge, a lot of people. And today, I would like to present you some Thai word if you go to Thailand.
Oh.
And you can say hello to people.
Oh, so we can all learn.
Sure.
Okay, oh,
let's go.
Great.
Let's go. Or actually, because it, like, for the first part I did, it's like, sweaty cup. Like this, it's like, hello.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to do the hand like this.
Oh, with the
hands. It's not like Cambodia or Laos or other ASEANs because like your elbow is like close to your body.
Oh.
So that's why it's different from other country.
Oh.
So the elbow is stuck in here. And then like you bow your head to the hand.
And you say,
Sawadee.
Sawadee.
Yeah, for the girl, it's Sawadee ka.
Oh.
For the guy, Sawadee kap.
Oh.
For example, for the guy, Sawadee kap.
Sawadee kap.
Sawadee kap. Girls. Nice! That's it.
Thank you. That was very useful in case we go to Thailand.
Sure.
Now, let's talk to Oliver. Oliver, you're from the United Kingdom.
Yep.
And your name seems to be very popular in your country. You have Jamie Oliver, Oliver Cromwell, and Oliver Twist, and you,
and yeah,
Oliver.
That's why I get my friends to call me Ollie. There's too many Olivers. It cramps my style.
You're an individual.
Okay. You know, speaking of style, you guys know that Oliver is a pretty famous DJ in Korea, right? Yes. I mean, we have to hear it.
We
have to hear it. Come on. Come on, Ollie.
Woo!
It's the kind of beat the go, it's the kind of beat the go, it's the kind of beat the go, ba ta ta ta. This is the kind of beat the go, ba ta 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 ta. It's the kind of beat the go, ba ta ta ta.
Oh.
I could be a pretty cool DJ, right?
Yeah, or a dancer. You've got both.
I could be a dancer / DJ.
And a singer by the sounds of it.
Okay, let's start the show. Let's start the competition. This is Bring It On. Yeah. Okay, each week we have a new topic and new items from new countries, and here is today's topic. Water. Now, Earth is 70% water, and all across the globe, there are ongoing efforts to utilize this resource more efficiently. Now, we took to the streets and listened to what our viewers had to say about today's topic, so let's watch. Global interactive presentation show, Bring It On. We have our very own smartphone application, so you can hear your voice. In season 4, we count the votes live in the studio so we can hear your voice better. You get to choose your favorite item.
I think that Thailand's floating market is like an interesting cultural attraction.
Oh, I chose that one because I used to live in Africa and water in Africa is very important to me.
I chose the public bath, Roman times, because Roman history fascinates me. I love Thailand. It's a fantastic place.
It's beautiful. It looks very fun.
Voting Thailand, I don't know what that means, but I'd like to go there.
Now, Thailand seems to be the popular choice among our viewers. Yes, Tachara.
Yes, of course.
I mean, what's so special about Thailand and its uses of water?
Oh, yeah, of course, that we live with the water for a long time ago, like, you know, 600 years ago, 1,000 years ago, and actually, since nowadays, we still have like a Thai Happy New Year, Thai New Year actually, every April. And we have, on that day, we have like Songkran Festival. And actually, Songkran Festival is like water festival. So actually, you can see on the video here, you can like spread water to anyone on the screen. 3 days, 13, 14, 15 April of every year, go to the street, spread the water as much as you want, to any people as you want.
Wait, so let me clarify. So that 3 days, you're allowed to go out to the street.
True.
And just spray water to strangers, and that's totally okay?
Yeah, that's fun. Like,
people you don't even know.
Yeah, I don't know, you just, I want to like spray water.
So what
what's the meaning of this then?
Yeah. Actually, you know what, April is summer. It's summertime, and it's really hot. It's like 42 degrees. So the people would like to, you know, celebrate the new year, and we would like to kind of like low down the temperature. Yeah. So that's why we spread the water to any people, and we celebrate the new year.
Mm. What about in the United Kingdom, Ollie, then?
Yeah, well, we don't have, like, we do kind of have festivals like that, but they're frowned upon, probably similar to in your country. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we have not many fun things to do in England. So we made a slide in Bristol. It's basically a 90-meter long slide, and on the first Sunday of every month, they try to stop the cars.
Wow.
They stop the cars from going into the city center.
Oh my
So instead of park and ride, whereas you would ride a bike, it's actually called park and slide. So you just go in and have fun.
Wow.
It's like 90 meters long, and it's funded by, I think, like the local charities or government or something. So it's all kind of like open for all.
Wow, that's funny like too.
Yeah, that looks fine.
Okay. What about in Zambia, Kent?
Well, we don't have something like, you know, in Thailand or in UK, but, well, we like have a lot of like natural water resources in the country.
Oh, right, the Victoria Falls.
The Victoria Falls, yes the mighty Victoria Falls. Actually, for the name, it would be very important to note that the actual local name is called Mosotunya, which means the smoke that thunders. And just there are a lot of activities you can do, like bungee jumping. Mm. And also we have a very natural pool. It's called the Devil's Pool. And it's really breathtaking because it's just next to the depth of the falls itself.
Now, we looked at what each country does with its water resources, and I can't wait to find out more about them in our presenters' presentations. Presentations are coming up soon, but here are the rules. We'll be right back. that was the rules. And this is how our scoring system works. From the judges, 40%. Studio audience, 10%. Bring it on application, 30%. And with the successful talkback session, one or two presenter will have the bonus 20%. Ooh. The votes will determine first, second, and third places. Now here on Bring It On, your opinion matters. Your vote counts for 30% of the total score. So log on to the Bring It On application and have your voice heard. But remember, if you're watching the show on air, voting for next week will be open. If you're watching the studio recording live via the Arirang TV website or YouTube, please do not forget to vote, but also send us your comment and suggestions. We love hearing from you.
Because they don't make any energy.
Well, no, correct? So that's why they make them to control the water.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I know. So that's.
Now, with that said, let's start the competition. Kicking things off today will be Ollie from the United Kingdom. His item is about the Roman bath. But before we hear from him, here is a video message from his supporters.
Good luck with this week on Bring It On, and hope you do well.
Good luck on Bring It On. Hope you do well, buddy.
Woo! This is for you, Ollie. I know you can do it. You got this. Bring it home, baby.
Hi, my name's Ollie. I'm from England. My presentation is on water resource utilization, specifically public baths. So in England, what better place to use than the city of Bath? Bath is in the southwest of England. It's about 2.5 hours west of London. There are three naturally occurring hot springs there. We've got Cross Spring, Hetling Spring, and King Spring. Together, they pump out over 1 million liters of water every day. The water comes out at a temperature of like 45 degrees C. It's been doing so for thousands of years. And the source is known to be rainfall that falls on the nearby lands and circulates back around. So why is it hot? The water is hot because it sinks to a depth of about 2,000 kilometers where it meets some hot rocks in the Earth's crust, which heat it up to a temperature of about 69 degrees C. And then it makes its way up through the limestone rocks and through the cracks and comes out in the springs in the city of Bath.
It was 2,000 years ago in a city called Bath in England. There was a man who came from Rome. This man discovered the hot springs gushing from the land. He enjoyed spas here every day.
Yes! I got a good idea! Monica!
His idea of turning it into a public bathhouse turned out to be a success, and news quickly spread throughout the world. This is the beginning of Bath as we know it.
That was good, wasn't it? Wow. Wasn't it?
Yeah!
Yeah.
Right. So in the Roman times, hot springs were believed to be the work of ancient gods, but now we know that's not the case, as I explained a second ago. The public baths were at the heart of the Roman lifestyle, so it wasn't just baths and keeping clean, it was also like a whole leisure complex around the baths. So they had like gyms, temples, saunas, hairdressing for the girls, and even brothels. So in modern day, so basically that attracted lots of visitors from all around the Roman Empire, and even in the modern days, like it attracts over 1 million visitors a year. And which equates, a survey showed that it equates to an estimated £15 million a year just for the tourist industry in Bath. So there used to be cheap entrance fees. The government made it cheap for them, for the public to use it. But now in England today, it's like £34 for 2 hours, which is expensive to some. Did you know the Romans visited the baths and spas 2 to 3 times a day? Did you know the thermal water contains over 43 different kinds of minerals? That's why it's believed to have healing properties. Did you know women and men usually bathe at separate times? So the women would be in the morning and the men would be in the afternoon. Did you know the springs before the Romans were used actually by the Celts and they were believed to have healed their prince of his leprosy? So I think the Romans came in and took over and made it into a bath rather than just like a spring. And then did you know that one of the services there was also a resident armpit hair plucking service? That one's for you, Amy. Any questions? Conclusion.
For your presentation. Thank you. Now let's take some questions first from our judges. Any questions for Ollie?
I've always wondered in these kind of baths how it's
clean.
Yeah.
Or, you know, it's not chlorinated, right?
So well, it goes in, so it comes out of the springs and then recycles out, and they put it in the Avon, River. But like, yeah, there was an issue a few years ago where I think something polluted the water. And then once that was discovered, actually it closed for a long time. But what they did to get around that is they made a new borehole, which instead of bringing it through this area of the spring, they make a new hole, and then they take the water from like maybe a deeper depth or something, so that it's not contaminated by anything, and then they just reroute it in through that.
So it's very clean.
And yeah, nice. They've got a computer system as well where they kind of check if there's anything on there because of what happened before. They kind of stepped up their game.
So the spa is working in summer and winter.
All year round.
And in the winter time, the temperature changes. That's a good point.
The water itself, when it comes out the springs, is at 45 degrees, but like now it's thought to be the optimal temperature is like 31.5 degrees. Mm-hmm. So all the spas are at that temperature and they stay that temperature.
Wow. So it's best to go in winter because the temperature is...
Well, it'll be out. If you're on the rooftop, it'd be cold outside and probably raining in England. Mm-hmm. And then it'll be warm, yeah.
Does it? What is it that makes those baths special? Is it some kind of special minerals that goes just in that city?
So all the different springs around the world, they obviously have certain amounts of minerals in them. You can test for that. So actually, Bath has got the highest number of minerals in England, I think, for like in its spring water. So that's why it's believed to be special. And the legend of the old Celtic king, Bladud, I think his name was. But so that's it's kind of, you know, it's got like a legend around it. So people bought into that and they kind of still do. So it's a good money spinner.
Wow, Ollie seemed to have all his answers ready. So that's all the time we have for question and answers. Now it's time to vote. Let's start with our studio audience. Studio audience, please get out your smartphones and get ready to vote. And now let's turn to our judges. Judges, please make up your minds. Judges, please make up your minds. And in 3, 2, 1, press the buzzer.
Really?
Really.
I told you today's in the bedroom.
Sorry.
Yeah, okay. 3 out of 4 from our judges. Of course, Ilya did not press the buzzer. Let's hear from the ones who did. Starting with you, Abigail.
I really like your presentation, the way you talk. I feel like you are very confident when you talk. And you are very sure about your information, so that's a very good point. And also, I like this Roman spa stuff because it's very echo, because you say the water comes up and then they put it out to a river. Yeah. So it's like a circle, it's going and coming back. So I think it's very good for the environment and for the people too, so I like it.
For me, the presentation was very uneven. I didn't like the presentation at all because it was really boring.
Sorry?
Don't hold back, though. Okay.
You know, don't try to sugarcoat it, either. You don't have to. Why are you being so nice?
I really liked your delivery. You're very confident and you really know your material and stuff, but I didn't like the way you presented your stuff. And I didn't like the presentation itself because you made a lot of focus on history stuff about Roman baths, that kind of period. I don't know what of that. If you're talking about thermal bath, what I want to know is why is it unique? What's so British about it? And what's so unique about it, like even in Britain? Because there are a lot of baths all around the world. So you're talking about Britain right now. So what's so unique about it in Britain?
Okay, yeah, that's actually a valid point. It didn't persuade Ilya. No, just enough to reach for the buzzer. But, Ollie, you did get 3 votes out of 4. Let's check our studio audience responses. Here are the studio points for Ollie. From the judges, 30 points. And from our studio audience, 7 points for a total of 37 points. So that's not bad.
Nice,
but we still have the online votes coming. So if you liked Ollie's presentation, please go on to our application and vote for Ollie.
Well, at least three of them voted for me, so that's good. I mean, it's only a game show, so even if you've got nothing, you shouldn't be too disappointed. But it's all good. I'm happy with 3 out of 4. Cool.
Next up, we have Kent from Zambia. His presentation is about the world's largest man-made lake. I'm sure we're all eager to hear more about his country, but first, let's watch a video message that arrived for him.
Kent Kamasunda, who is participating in the program from Zambia. As far as I'm concerned, he has taken a fantastic subject and is already a winner. He's number one.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kent, and I'm here to present to you about Lake Kariba of Zambia. I'm from Zambia, and it's a country that is surrounded by 8 countries. It is a landlocked country, but it boasts of a lot of water resources. Now, before I go deep in my presentation, let's sit and relax and watch this video. There are a lot of dams in the world. Canada's Daniel Johnson Dam, Ghana's Akosombo Dam, Egypt's Aswan High Dam, Russia's Brask Dam. If so, then what is the world's largest dam? Surprise, surprise, Zambia's Kariba Dam. The world's largest dam is Kariba Dam, located in Zambia. And from the dam, the world's biggest man-made lake was made. Yeah, that caught you by surprise, I guess. Yes, the world's biggest dam in the world is located in Zambia. And it's from the dam where the mighty Lake Kariba was born. So now, how was the Lake Kariba formed? First, the construction of the dam started in 1955 by a joint venture between Zimbabwe and Zambia. This construction lasted for about 5 years. It was constructed by an Italian construction company. And in 1963, when the floodgates of the dam were opened, that's when the dam was born. So, how big is Lake Kariba? Imagine Seoul. Wow. Now, 10 times the size of Seoul. That's the size of Lake Kariba. Its size is about 226 kilometers long and about 40 kilometers wide. It is, arguably, for the past 6 years, the world's biggest man-made lake with 4 islands on it. Now, this Kariba Dam, this Lake Kariba is very important to the Zambians, and I want to tell you how much important it is to the Zambians. First, I'll talk about the utilizations. Well, in the case of utilization, the dam was created first for hydroelectricity purposes. And in this case, first, in terms of energy, about 1,626 megawatts are produced every day from this lake and the dam. And then also, the other thing is farming. Around this area, a lot of local people located there doing the farming. And also fisheries. It's very popular for fish because when the lake was formed, fish from different parts of the country and different parts of Africa were brought in the river. And also household usages, drinking and bathing. Now, economic-wise, there is a lot of benefits that is benefiting to the country. First, the export of electricity to countries nearby up to South Africa, and also export of fish and employment about 6,000. Importantly, it is a symbol of peace because
and
it is located.
Time's up.
Thank you
Sorry,
very much.
Sorry, Kent, I'm going to have to stop you right there. Now, I'm sure our judges have some questions for Kent. Who would like to start us off?
How is the distribution of the water of this dam? Where is going the water?
So the distribution of the water comes from Zambezi River, mm-hmm. and then there's a dam which is created, which is called Kariba Dam. And then with the dam, if you know how the dam operates, they have to close up the gate yeah. and then open at a specific time of the year. Now, when the waters are open, the waters flow through the lake. So they flow through this valley where, you know, now, which formed Lake Kariba mm-hmm. itself.
Yeah. yeah, so like I heard that it's good, like there is good point constructing them,
yes.
but I heard there was also a lot of bad points mm-hmm. about it. Like, for example, in Egypt, like there was some kind of problem with this.
Yes.
So was there any problems in Zambia because of this Kariba Dam?
Yes, that's a very good question. Well, when the dam was being constructed, of course, we had, during that time, was still being colonized by Great Britain. Yeah. And so it was, you know, the governments that were deciding on that. Now, with the local people, the indigenous people lived there for 1,000 years, now, mm-hmm. doing the farming and everything. But the only problem which was there was because of the flooding. Every year, at least they have to move out to higher land because of the flooding. So the reasoning of the government was, you know, instead of doing the, you know, the moving and back and forth, it's safe, you, we take you to higher lands, and then the belt schools out there for them. And then, so for the bad side, I would say the people lost their indigenous land. But on the good part, would say, well, at least now their lives are saved. Because every flooding, many people will die, animals will die, and stuff like that. Yes.
Okay, but you seem to have all your answers ready. It's like a textbook answer, so I'm very impressed.
Did a lot of research.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's see if you can answer our audience questions the same way. Studio audience, do you have any questions for Kent? Yes.
The amount of energy that Lake Kariba is producing, is it enough to fulfill the energy requirement of the whole country? Or is there any energy that the government of Gambia is exporting to other countries?
Oh, thank you very much. Actually, I first have to make a first point. It's not Gambia, it's Zambia. There's another African country called Gambia. And in terms of energy, I must say there are two hydroelectricity companies located at the dam. The dam south is called the Kariba South, which is owned by the Zimbabwean authority, and then the Zambian side is Kariba North. And in terms of the Kariba North, it has about 5 generators that are actually placed at the power generation company at the spot, and it produces each generator produces about 150 megawatts per hour. That is enough to actually light up the whole country, and enough to export to nearby Mozambique, which is having problems with electricity. We actually export until actually South Africa too. So there's enough.
Wow, okay. Thank you, Kent. That's all the time we have for questions, and it's time to vote. Let's start with our studio audience. Studio audience, please get out your smartphones and get ready to vote. And now let's turn to our judges. Judges, what will it be? Your vote becomes final on my count of 3. Your vote becomes final on my count of 3. 3, 2, 1. Press the buzzer.
Oh, really?
Three out of 4. Okay, so that was, there was a little confusion, but in conclusion, we have 4 votes out of 4 for Kent. Perfect score from our judges, and even Ilya voted, so let's hear why. Starting with Amy.
I thought you were a little bit nervous, to be honest, and I think maybe you can get over that in your future presentation, just feeling a little bit more confident. Like, the confidence that you brought to the Q&A section was perfect.
Yeah.
Okay, and what about you, Ilya?
Well, the reason is basically really simple. I like smart people, and you're very smart.
Thank you.
during the Q&A session, you just jungled with all the figures and facts, and that was just awesome. I like how confident you are. I like do know your topic, and after this presentation, I got the feeling that I know pretty much everything about this dam. So for that reason, I voted.
Okay, so Kent received a perfect score from our judges. Let's find out the total studio score for Kent. Here are the studio points for Kent. From the judges, a perfect score, 40 points. And from our studio audience, 5.5 points for a total of 45.5 points. Very good, Kent. But we still have that 30%. We still have the Vote Swimmer application. So if you liked Kent's presentation, please go onto our application and vote for Kent.
Yeah, actually, I feel very, very, very grateful to the judges. Thanks a lot. I mean, they gave me the full scores. It's not easy, but I'm very grateful. Yeah, and I promise I'm gonna do better in the future.
Our last presenter is Tachara from Thailand, but before we hear from him, here is a video message.
I would like to ask you guys to send him a big love and support. I'm sure you guys will like him and enjoy his show.
I hope everybody would give my friends your support and also cheer him up in the Bring It On show. Tacha, fighting!
Please support him for Bring It On season 4.
So-so-ha!
Fighting!
Fighting!
Hi guys, I'm Tachat Longpasoy from Thailand. Let's take a look at the video.
Thailand is known as the wettest of the East because our country is surrounded with many canals and rivers where originate from big three rivers. By this geographic characteristic, therefore, we have started using these resources and change it little by little.
Ta-da! How's it? Would you like to go to Thailand?
As I told you, we used to be called like the Venice of the East because, like, as you can see on the here on the top, it's Venice, Italy. As you can see, the location we have like surrounded with the weird water. And look at it 600 years ago at Ayutthaya, it's a Yam. We have the location is quite similar, same to Venice, Italy. Even right now, nowadays, it's Bangkok, Thailand. You can see here have a lot of canals, rivers around the city. And look at the GDP in 2014 is the newest one. So you can see the silver is 52.7%, which means like on the tourism, the tourist attraction is the most income that we get from around the world, from the GDP. So you can see here on 2015, and it's gonna be grow up 2025 on the here. So our core resources is the water, is the main important of our resources, and plus the main source of our income. So therefore, we decided to make this kind of project a floating market tourist attraction. So 100%, as you can see here, on the right-hand side of the photo here is the original local floating market, which is called like Damnun's Duok Rajaburi Province, is 65%. We have this kind of this market a lot, like 65%. And actually we have like this kind of local government make it, like 15%, as you can see on the right-hand side of the photo here. It's local government make it. And we have the private company make it as well on 20%. And what we sell, of course, that is the market. So fruit, food, and everything. And what we get, what the benefit we get from this thing is we can create more job and we expand market not only for the local, which is not only for the community, but we expand to the global as well. So whole the world will know this kind of thing. And we increase the value as well, not just only market. It's called to be like, it changed to be the tourist attractions. And it's advertisement tourism. And more of that, we set up a standard as well, because if we do not control, the environment will be corrupt and the environment will get wrong. So that's why like the government will support the city and will support the local people to help each other to make the floating market to be, to lead to global. Thank you.
And right on time. Thank you for your presentation, Tachara. Let's take some questions. Who would like to start us off?
Why floating market? Why, like, I know there is a lot of rivers in Thailand, sure. But why, especially in the river, you should, like, is there a particular reason Thailand people made a floating market?
Well, actually, like I told you, because like floating market, it's actually is not the thing that we make it. It's something like since the past like 600 years ago, and we make it to be tourism because I told you it's the main resources, it's the main important, it's the core value that we have, and plus the core income that we get, 52% mm-hmm. 0.7, like 52.7%. That's from our income, GDP income, the whole that thing is from tourism, plus together to be floating market. Because water resources is the main, right? And tourists are the same. Make it to be happen. That's it, the flooding market.
Mm-hmm. One more. Okay. Do they pay something to the government to have these boats and do
working
in the market?
Yeah, because that's the thing, because like the local people actually they have their own boats in the past, but they don't have money enough to expand the market. So it's government help them to support them and control the environment. Because as I told you, because if you do not control here, the environment is going to be ruined. Like, you know, the trash, the food, the garbage is going to throw out. So government support, like, really have to come in and help them and organize everything.
Okay, thank you, Tashara. I've got to say, I love the enthusiasm and the energy that you brought to the table during your presentation and your Q&A session. Let's see how they responded by voting. Let's start with our studio audience. Studio audience, please get out your smartphones and get ready to vote. And now for our judges. Judges, please get ready to vote. Your vote becomes final on my count of three. Judges, please get ready to vote. Your vote becomes final on my count of three. Three, two, one. Press the buzzer. Press the buzzer.
Please.
It's okay.
Well, you know you want to.
I'm the bad guy now.
It's okay. Three out of four.
You don't want to be the mean, right?
But Robin.
Well, I don't know. That's the thing, because he seemed to be really nice and generous all the time. But surprise, surprise, like Ilian voted me. That's really surprised as well, because at the first time, I thought like it's going to be only two girls vote for me. But it's turned point to be like Ilian vote for me. Yeah, so it's okay. I understand him.
Let's start with you, Ilya. Why did you vote?
Yeah.
Okay, that was on a verge. That was really on a verge of me not voting. The presentation was so-so. The Q&A session was so-so.
Like but I said, once again, please don't sugarcoat anything. Us. Really, we can take it.
What I really liked is your enthusiasm. You were really passionate about the topic you were talking about. And you were pretty much very good with your answers to our questions. And yes, that brought me over for that just millimeter thing for me to vote for you.
Wow.
Hey, now, Robin.
Why?
What is wrong with you?
Why?
Okay, I will start with the good points first. So I will start with the good points. So I really like your presentation, like the delivery of it. So you were smiling the whole time. And like, you know, I feel that energy. So that was a really good point for me. But as I said, always, presentation comes first. Like, delivery is second for me. And contrary to Ilya, I hate math. I hate math. And,
that's
you know,
hard.
Like for me, the reason you're here is to, like, make me want to come to Thailand.
Yeah.
And you spend half of your presentation just doing the background, the introduction. And, like, you are kind of rushing it at the end. Yeah. And during the Q&A, you know, like, we all feel there was a lot of questions. And if there is a lot of questions, it basically means that during the presentation, you didn't show us all you have to show.
Okay, so three out of four from our judges. Now, what did our studio audience think of Tachara's presentation? Here are the studio points for Tachara. From the judges, 30 points. And from our studio audience, 7.5 points for
that's
total
a draw, right?
Exactly.
37.5
exactly
points.
Like
Now, our judges were pretty generous today, so our studio points are relatively high compared to previous weeks, but we still have that 30% that comes from you, your vote. Please go on to our Bring It On application and vote for your favorite presentation. Like I said, it counts for 30% of the total score. Now, in the meantime, we have that extra 20% coming up. It's time for the Fast and the Furious, or actually in this week's case, Wet and Wild, it's time for the Talkback. It's time for the Talkback. It's a chance for our presenters to attack and fight back. Now, the studio audience will give the extra 10 points, and our judges will give the other 10. Okay, guys, don't try to wade in. Dive right into it. That was my water drip for today. Okay, you know what to do. Guys, you have 3 minutes to outwit your rivals, and your time starts now.
Ladies first.
What?
Oh, this is, okay, it's a custom. Yep. I thought it was this one.
Please go ahead and you know, tell us more about Thailand.
I thought you're gonna first. You're the first one.
All right, I'll go first. Let's put things straight up here. First, sure. I'll go first for the floating market.
Yeah,
for you know, market. We're just looking at the picture. We can sure. see that the water is really dirty.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really dirty. And when the question was okay. being asked to say, okay. you know, how are you helping the people not to dump the water, I mean, the dirty in the water?
Okay.
And then later the audience asked you to say, okay. you know, in terms of bad weather,
okay.
how well do you help the people not to be affected in terms of bad weather?
And you told us and, that it was, yeah, you told us that it mm-hmm. was closed once a week, but you didn't tell us about the how it is with the bad weather, the seasonal weather comes in. So
all right, can I answer you guys?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Thank you for the questions of that. Actually, I answered the audience and answered just already. Like we have to regulate as well. You have when you dump the trash on the river, you have to fine. You have to pay the fine.
How many police do you have? Like you know, enforcing.
We have to cover there.
Because
so
when I went there and it was like really dirty. And so if there was someone, you could, if I was paid to mm-hmm. catch people throwing rubbish in there, mm-hmm. I'd probably be a rich man. I don't work for the Thai government.
So. Well, that's the thing. It's like so. That's why, like, actually, I would like to give you an example, though. For example, China government, before, like, you know, they have to educate the people before to come to other country. That's a well-being.
Enforce the laws. Let's
not talk about China. All right, let's talk about what
please,
Thailand is doing.
Let me answer. Okay, finish.
Turn.
Okay. Please.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. That's it. And that's the thing, you have to like rate, you have to follow the rule
yeah.
that you have to do. That's the thing that you have to learn how to yeah. you know, have to respect the tourist attraction.
Yeah.
And moreover than that, not just the fine that you have to pay, but we have to regulate that, you have to clean up and everything.
Enforce that.
Okay,
so
great.
I think,
no, I get answer, it. Oh, I think answer, that's very good answer, but I think.
Okay,
that's not. Let me just say something. Let me just say
I
something.
I think it's
okay.
many.
Okay, yeah.
Okay,
okay.
Switch up.
Okay, now let me switch
calm
up.
Calm down.
Let me switch down.
Calm down. Yeah, let me ask you a question.
Okay.
That's an interesting question.
Sure.
For the dam, like we know that it affects a lot. For example, like the dam, when you make a dam, mm-hmm. on the behind of that,
yeah.
they change all environment. For example, like the fish or like the water resources inside the water resources, they change everything.
I got one as well. When the water level gets too low yes. and the dam doesn't work, what do you do in that case? Because I read that actually when the water's too low, you don't make any energy from the
so
dam.
So that's why they make
and
the
that's
dam.
That's a big problem.
No, that part they
no,
make the dam,
because they don't make
man.
Any energy.
Well, no, so that's why they make the dam to control the water.
Well, thank you very much, Jesse.
Yeah, I know. So that's why I protect you, man, because yeah. it's not nonsense at all.
What?
That's
they don't have enough water to power
no,
the dam.
No, it's on the boot.
When there's no water, then what are you going to do? You have a dam with no water.
So that's why they make a dam to control that. But however, for the extra...
Okay, now, we should talk about it.
Oh my God, it's really hard as well because I need to control the emotional, the emotion of the people. I need to control like the feeling. I need to control like the content. And I need to answer the question as well at the same time. So it's really hard, but I enjoy that so much.
I think it was great because I was just actually very, very interesting because I thought maybe people might attack me a lot, meaning that I may have high scores from the judges. So I thought maybe the whole, all of the two guys would be attacking me more and more.
Okay, time's up for our talkback session. Now it's up to our judges and our studio audience to award that extra 20 points. So judges, please huddle up, and studio audience, please make up your minds as well. Our judges and our studio audience, they've reached a decision. So let's hear it, starting with our judges. Who will make the announcement?
I will.
Okay, let's hear it.
Okay, I will make the announcement, and I'm definitely not going to sugarcoat it.
Okay.
That was the worst talkback session in Bring It Out history. That was the boring 3 minutes we've seen so far on this show. And Ollie, you were practically absent at the conversation.
Yeah, I did have my back to you as well.
We didn't hear nothing, anything from you. Kent, you were okay, but we didn't hear you attacking or defending yourself. You were just putting these meaningless phrases in between, in the middle, that's it. And Tachara, you were stolen the time. You did nothing. You were just trying to take the time. Or, can I please talk? Okay, thank you. Now I will talk. That's not the talkback session. Speak, okay? And so for that reason, we decided that we will. Not give 10 points to anyone. Not give 10 points to anyone.
Ooh.
Okay. So nobody, not one, receives our judges 10 points. It's a first, but I respect our judges' opinion, so I will allow it. So nobody receives the 10 points from our judges. Now you only have our studio audience's extra 10 points. And that 10 points goes to...
Oh.
The winner is... Tachara. Oh. Congratulations. Okay, this is a first, so I don't really know what to do, but, okay, our judges decided not to give the extra 10 points, and that's all from the studio, and we still have the application votes, and they've just closed. We will be back with the total score, so don't go away. It's time to hear the verdict. We've added all the points from our judges, our studio audience, our application, and the final talkback session. And I have the final results in my hand. Now, today is the fourth preliminary round of Bring It On Season 4. So whoever finishes last place today will be eliminated from the competition. As always, I will start by announcing the third place, the hardest part of the show. Coming in third place with 45.43 points is Ollie. We're sorry.
Don't be sorry.
I mean, you did give a pretty convincing presentation, and you did get most of the votes from our judges.
Thank you.
So you must be, I mean, it's disappointing, right?
I'm devastated,
right?
Yeah, I'm devastated. I was really hoping to win, and yeah, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I might have to go and have a cold beer. Maybe in a spa, you know, get it out of my system.
Okay, we're sorry to see you go, but rules are rules. But thanks for your great presentation.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, how about a round of applause for Ollie? And now for the runner-up and today's winner, Kent and Tachara. Are you ready to hear the big announcement?
Yep, bring it on.
Hey, guys, step right up. One of these two presenters is today's winner. Now, Kent received a perfect score from our judges. But Tachara did get that bonus 10 points in the end. So who will become today's winner? Got a total of 60 60.79 wow. points.
Wow. Very high.
Wow. Yes. Runner up got 53.78 points. Today's winner is today's winner is Tachara, congratulations! Wow.
Judges, studio audience, Bring It On app, bonus point, and the final score.
Tachara, 60.79 points total. That's a pretty high score.
I didn't know that too, actually.
Of course you didn't know that.
I mean, like,
of course.
Yeah, I know, but like, it's really surprising. I'm a little bit sad though, because like, I heard from the judge that on the, you know, when we talk about like the 10% score mm-hmm. that we should get, and yeah, I stolen the team. I don't know, I feel get close to both of them, so I really wish like, three of us to go through the next round, but you know, competition, man. I'm sorry.
That's my one.
Yeah.
And Kent, 53.78 points. If you had gotten that extra points, you know, things could have gone a little differently.
I think going up to the next round, I'm gonna, you know, bring on my game, I think, and try hard to bring in all the debates. And then follow the rules and everything. Make sure that I think maybe if I get that extra point from the judges, might be great. So I'm promising you judges, next time, I expect more powerful debates from me.
Oh, okay. So you got a little lucky today. You still have a second shot at being in the competition. So congratulations, Kit, and congratulations to you, Tachara. And we're sorry for Ollie. We're sorry to see you leave. But regardless, we did enjoy your presentation.
Thank you.
So how about another big round of applause for our three amazing presenters? Yep. Survival presentation show, Bring It On. On each episode, three presenters will promote their home countries, and you get to decide who gets to stay in the competition. So log on to our Bring It On application and vote for your favorite presenter. It's going to be a fierce battle of wills, skills, and charms. We're going to have to say goodbye to Ollie, but we'll be back next week with three new presenters. So I'll see you next week. Until we introduce all fascinating items from around the world, we will continue to bring it on. See you next week, folks. Woo-hoo! 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 Woo-hoo!